Once I'll open it, I'll just start, sir.
Yeah, please.
Okay, good evening, and thanks Dr. NK sir and Dr. Durga Prasad sir for the kind introduction. Without wasting much time, I will go to the topic. So my overview of presentation would be on the history of the flexible bronchoscopy. What are the scopes available? What are the various types of scopes, indications, complications, and some of the common case scenarios which would be seeing in our day-to-day practice. So the history way back in the year 1897, when the first bronchoscopic clinical application was done by Dr. Professor Killian, who is the father of bronchoscopy, who has removed a pork bone from the right main bronchus. In 1962, Shijito Ideda with his flexible bronchoscope was instrumental in developing a flexible bronchoscope. And in 1978, Wood and Flink used the first flexible bronchoscopy in children. So it was in the adults it was started, and slowly in the year 1978, it is Dr. Wood and Dr. Flink which used the flexible bronchoscopy. In 1981, the fiber optic scopes were in the children were available. Now I had the opportunity, he is Dr. Robert Wood, who is the pioneer in the flexible bronchoscopy. I had the opportunity in working with him. These are the various, the flexible bronchoscopy, which started with ultra thin to the big size of the bronchoscope. Now, what are the different size? You have 4.8, 3.6, 2.8, 2.2, and 1.8, which I don't know, but 2.2 is the ultra thin by the Olympus scope, where you don't have any suction channel. Neither you can use a biopsy forceps. It is in a newborn and infants where you have a preterm child who has been intubated with a 3.5 size tube. You can use a 2.2. Or a 2.8 would also be sufficient, but the air, the you have only 0.7 millimeter gap, so it would be very difficult for the aeration, but still you can try. So we have a four sides of Olympus 1, where you have a suction channel of 2. So these are the things which are available. I'll show you in the next slide. These are the high resolution bronchoscopes which are available in the FUSI system. This is high quality video. These are fiber optic scopes, which you have a camera and you need to fix it. This costs about somewhere around 7 to 8 lakhs. But whereas a 190 series scope costs around 30 lakhs. So the because it is an ultra modified scope, the video scope is the new version. You have a 150 series, which was an old version. And you have a 4 and a 2.8 right now. So what are the prerequisite of bronchoscopy? Now, most of the people would say, sir, I've been trained with the bronchoscopy. I've been since last 7-8 years, I've been working. I've gone to various bronchoscopy workshops. I've attended Dr. Vijay Shekharan's, Dr. Mahesh Babu from Singapore, Dr. Robert Wood from USA. And then I did my pulmonary fellowship from Australia. So once I go and get trained and you say I'm a bronchoscopist, no, you have to get a bit expertise. So you have to know the correct indication of flexible bronchoscopy. I'll tell you, in US, the number of bronchoscopies they used to do were nearly 7 to 8 per day. Whereas in Australia, it was 4 to 8 per week. In China, where I've gone for an interventional pulmonology workshop, they also do lots of amazing things. So appropriate size of the bronchoscope you should have. You should have what are the size available, whether you can use it for the child or not. What the NK sir said, all size does matter for here. And you have the facility and the skill for bronchoscopy. And most importantly, monitoring. You just do a bronchoscopy and go is does not sufficient. And you should have the facility and skills for cardiopulmonary resuscitation. And you have to have an informed consent from parents and guardians. And you should immediately send the sample for BAL, at least for a cytopathology, which includes your neutrophils and your lymphocytes and everything in a BAL. And you can send for culture. There are some special stains which are not available in Vijayawada. I'm talking about for Vijayawada nearby, where you need to send to Hyderabad. And you should have a facility for video recording. Generally, we do have. Now, what are the indications? Now, if you have a persistent stridor, you have an unexplained or persistent wheeze. That could be a monophonic wheeze or a biphonic or a what you call a multiphonic wheeze. You can have an unexplained or persistent cough, and you should have a strong suspicion for a suspected foreign body. So somebody would have said, why you are saying a foreign body? Foreign body is the domain of the rigid scopy or an ENT specialist. And sometimes when it is in the lower airway, you need to have a conduit, but which means in a rigid scope, you pass your flexible bronchoscope and then you can remove a foreign body. I and an adult pulmonologist, we did a removal of a coconut piece by a flexible bronchoscope. We haven't put that video because of the time constraints. Then you have a persistent or recurrent consolidation or rectal access. So a pediatrician should understand a pulmonologist is an what you call a complementary to a pediatrician. You see an X-ray and you see there is a single lobe involvement each time, and you should think there is something which is happening in the child. So you need to investigate further. Then most of the people would think a CT or something would be sufficient. For looking at the airway dynamicity, the flexible bronchoscope is the only instrument right now which is available which you can see. Neither your 3D construction virtual bronchoscopy doesn't help much. Or a recurrent persistent infiltrates also you need to recruit. And a localized pulmonary hyperlucency is one more indication. And for identification of the cause, I'll show you one of the cases how we could identify, we came to a diagnosis for a child. And for a cystic fibrosis, as child of cystic fibrosis, it is very difficult to clear the airway secretion. Sometimes in Australia where the secretions are thick, we need to do a bronchoscopy. Or if the child is not responding to your line of management, you need to get an organism for a better treatment, then you need to do a bronchoscopy. Hemoptysis, yes, you should have a rigid scope and you know how to, you should stop the bleeding also. So hemoptysis is one thing which you have to be a bit careful. And when you have a difficult intubation, definitely a bronchoscope would definitely help you how to, in a difficult intubation, you have a fixed jaw or something, when you have retrognathia, which is very difficult, then it will help you. There are flexible laryngoscopies which are also helpful for your intubation, but your bronchoscopy also does help. Now, difficulty in extubation. I should thank many of the pediatricians, especially Dr. Ramarao sir, who has given me a number of opportunity, because there are patients who have been stuck on ventilator. They are very difficult to extubate. Then they used to call for a bronchoscopy. Look, please look down what is happening. And when you suspect a case of tracheoesophageal fistula. Now, what are the complications? The commonest complication, when you explain to the mother, people would be afraid when you're doing a procedure. Generally, they do with a laryngeal mask. In Indian setting, we do with a short GA or a local anesthesia if the child is compliant. So the commonest complications are desaturation post-procedure, a bit of cough because you're irritating the airway, and there could be mild airway bleeding. And sometimes Dr. Bob Wood has said one of his cases, the bronchoscopy had got stuck in the airway and was very difficult to remove, and they broke the bronchoscope. So sometimes it happens when they have a spasm, they bite the bronchoscope and your fibers get disturbed or destroyed. So I would show you one of the Bob Wood's video before understanding what exactly is happening, you should know what is a normal anatomical this thing. So that I will show you one quick video of a normal bronchoscopy. So this is the carina. It is the left main bronchus and right main bronchus. It is the posterior tracheal membrane.
You can see not able to see.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Just a second, sir. Just a second, sir. Sorry, sir. If you're, I'll show you at the end, sir, because now you're still able to see my screen, sir.
Yeah, bro.
Okay, fine. Now, this is a case number one. I will show you the normal bronchoscopy video at the end. Please forgive me for that. Now, this is a case number one, Master Y, who is a one and a half month old who has referred for noisy breathing since 2 weeks of age, which everybody do see commonly. And there was a reduced noisy breathing while he was lying on the lateral side and increased when the baby was crying or when he developed a cold. There were no dysphoric features, which includes your retrograthia or somewhere a large tongue would also cause such type of noisy breathing. And neurocutaneous markers, otherwise the child was thriving well. And the systemic examination was unremarkable. Now, I hope you will be able to hear my audio. Are you able to hear my audio, sir?
Yeah.
So this is the noisy breathing, which is an inspiratory stridor everybody would have appreciated by now. And when the child cries, there would be much more substernal retractions. Now, this is the child at 6 months of age. Sorry for the background noise, because it was taken at their home. But still, you are able to still appreciate the inspiratory stridor, but there were no retractions. Now, these are the common cases we generally see. This child, because of the noisy breathing, went to two different pediatricians, got admitted, got nebulizations done, but there was no improvement. So people start running from one place to other place because of the noisy breathing. The most important point, I am not showing a bronchoscopy video for a normal child because this child didn't require a bronchoscopy, but I will show you the next case, which is really fascinating. So you need to counsel the parents that this stridor would subside by age, give time. When he has a cold or some respiratory tract infection, his sternal retractions would be bit much deeper. So you need to come to the hospital to check for the saturation. The child is saturating well, no distress, don't run after sound. People are more worried of sound. So you need to counsel the parents, please don't run after the sound. Now, this is one interesting case which I've got referred from Guntur Government Hospital. This is a baby X who is a 20 days old, born to a third degree consanguineous parents, referred for bronchoscopy for suspected tracheoesophageal fistula, because the child had aspiration pneumonia. That's what they were suspecting. The child had a weak shrill cry. He was a bit hypotonic, noticed a little later, and the child birth weight was 2.5 kgs. And the child was there for us. We thought some infective process. We have sent her the secretions for culture and sensitivity. Grew nothing. We have treated with antibiotics. 1 month post our treatment, the child was still did not improve the weight. So there was no history of choking while feeding, and the child was not gaining weight. The child was term appropriate for gestation age female, and there were no intranatal and natal complications. Now, this is the X-ray. You can see there's a pericardiac, perihilar edginess. Now, this is the video. I think everybody are able to hear the shrill cry. And you can see how the child is crying. It is a shrill cry. And the child was brought with open mouth. That's it. The child was persistently opening of the mouth. This is the only complaints, and they referred to me for as to rule out tracheoesophageal fistula. So I have sent all the cultures. I am thankful to Dr. Bindu Madhavi, who has helped us in diagnosing. Because in spite of all the things, the child, when I did a bronchoscopy, I will definitely show this. These are the feeding videos, which you can see there is no choking, but the child was sucking. Okay. And this is after post feeding. A bit difficulty in swallowing, if you can see. You can hear the gurgling sound. Why should a child of 20 day old, a normal child, should have a persistent gurgling? There were lots of pooling of secretions. So all would think this is a case of laryngomalacia. Now this child definitely needs, because they have sent for a bronchoscopy, we should never deny when a referring doctor is sending for a bronchoscopy because they're suspecting with some doubt. So this hope I could be able to share. Sir, please let me know if I'm unable to open up. Sorry, sir, I will just close and I'll. Sir, you're able to see my screen, sir? That is also gone, sir.
Yeah, screen you are able to see.
Okay. So. You're able to see this one also, sir?
Yeah, yeah, that we are able to see.
Okay, sir, fine. Then you will be able to see this one also, sir. Sir, now you're able to see, sir?
Yeah, yes, yes. Please go ahead.
Okay, sir. Now, I'll just point it out because there's lots of pooling of secretions. And there is a fogging of the camera. This is a 2.8 scope. Now you can see the arytenoid folds, which are flopping down. Definitely there is amount of laryngomalacia. But is it because of the what issue? Is it because of weakness of the muscles there, or it is the weakness of the central nervous system? So because of hypotonia, not gaining weight and height, we had to have sent this case to Bindu Madhavi. She has done an NCV and everything and found out to be a case of spinal muscular atrophy. But that time the trial was going on nusinersen, which if you give intrathecally would have prevented the death, because when I was in Australia, the trial had started. The end point is the death of a child. So SMA presenting people suspected of tracheoesophageal fistula had the pooling of secretions, definitely had a laryngomalacia. With laryngomalacia, you can have a GR. So a bit of laryngomalacia. It is mostly benign. It is a self-limited disorder. It is the most common congenital laryngeal anomaly in 50% to 75%, and is the most common cause of stridor in infants. The term laryngomalacia suggests that the cartilage of larynx is abnormally soft, which you have seen there. Frequently associated with gastroesophageal reflex. So it could be vice versa. So laryngomalacia and gastroesophageal may coincide with each other. So whenever you see a pooling of secretions, not only the child is not thriving well, this is an indication where you need to refer to a bronchoscopist or a pulmonologist for a flexible bronchoscopy to know whether it is a true laryngomalacia or a laryngeal web or a laryngeal cleft. So this can have episodes of microaspiration, which you have seen in the X-ray. So generally, what you are seeing is the onset of inspiratory stridor usually within first 4 to 6 weeks of life. So the people would have come, sir, noting, because I have seen recently one case which have been seen at nearly after the birth itself. I could have seen the stridor. Parents were a bit hesitant to get a bronchoscopy, convinced because the child was growing well. I said, okay, we will wait and see. If the child is not gaining weight, we'll definitely go ahead and do a bronchoscopy, because to convince the parents for a bronchoscopy of such an invasive procedure is a bit difficult. Infant's voice and cry are normal. Why is it so? So why is this point I have brought? It is because when you have a somewhere in a vocal cord involvement, then you can see a shrill cry, or what you call a muffled voice or a muffled cry. The stridor varies considerably with posture and airflow. That is the reason when you ask to child to make in a left lateral or right lateral position, the sound would definitely reduce, and it increases while crying or while the child gets agitated. And you can see the increased respiratory efforts while feeding. Stridor tends to evolve with time. That means it makes sometimes to 18 months to 24 months. We need to have patience. Only thing, if the child is growing well, nothing to do, please. Again, in most cases, no specific therapeutic measures are needed. But in severe cases who are not being developing well, not gaining weight, then definitely you need a surgical treatment in the form of sephroglastoplasty. But also remember, in a case of severe obstructive severe laryngomalacia, you can see an obstructive sleep apnea. Most important, you should also look for dysmorphic features. Peary-Robbins syndrome, retrognathia, these are all the things where you need to look into people when you have noisy breathing at the inspiratory stridor. And rarely tracheostomy. Please do understand, tracheostomy is not the treatment of choice for your laryngomalacia. Now, these are the different ways of laryngomalacia, how you could see in a flexible laryngoscopy. And remember, never use a topical anesthesia while you are doing a flexible bronchoscopy, because it aggravates your laryngomalacia. Now, This is the Hollinger type of classification. There are five types of classification, which I don't think that the normal pediatrician should know, because once we do a bronchoscopy, we'll definitely tell you the classification. So these are other types. This is the common, which you most of the people use as type 1, type 2, type 3, which is 66% is type 1. So this is the severe form. You can see the posterior caudal suction of epiglottis to the posterior pharyngeal wall. There is an area epiglottic folds. You are seeing this child, this type of type 1 in the video which I have presented. So this is the commonest of your inspiratory stridor. Now, this is a case number 3. Baby Z, 6 months old, noisy breathing since 2 to 3 months of age. This case has been referred from Kakinada because the child has been having repeated admissions for this noisy breathing. Getting admitted, getting nebulizations, frequently it's a bit okay for one or couple of weeks, and then again the child develops stridor. So there was no improvement, otherwise the child was thriving well. On examination, revealed a bright red mark behind the nape of the neck. By this description, you might have noticed there is something which everybody are interested in. And you should know there's a biphasic stridor and the rest of the systemic examination is normal. Now I'll show, these are the... So if everybody are able to appreciate a V's type sound under stridor, so this is a biphasic stridor, which I will show you in the next video. This is the same thing. So you are seeing the retractions. So all striders would not be laryngomalacia. If you wouldn't seen at the nape of the neck, you wouldn't have noticed. And you are able to hear both VZ sound and a strider, which is a biphasic strider, which once you know the diagnosis. Now, sorry again, this some of the videos has been, I'm not able to show in this, so I have to go back and. Okay. Please, friends, please have a careful observation at the vocal cord. You are seeing some red color structure here. I'm just pointing out the arrow. If everybody are able to appreciate at the vocal cord a red color like mass at the vocal cord, that is a subglottic hemangioma, which I will show you. Now, this is the child when I first saw at the time of presentation. Then there are a number of studies what to start and what not to start. Previously, they used to do a surgery, laser, and a corticosteroid therapy. But after starting a propranolol at 1 mg per kg per day in 2 divided doses, which have increased to 2 to 3 milligram per kg of day, this is after 3 months, this is after 6 months, and this is at 1 year, the child is being followed with me on a teleconsultation basis on this. But I repeated a bronchoscopy at 6 months of age. There was a different reduction in the hemangioma size. At the first time, I couldn't pass the scope through the vocal cords to the carina. But at the second visit, I could definitely pass the scope to the carina, could see the visualization of right and left bronchopulmonary, all the segments. So this is an interesting case. Please do understand that all striders that are V's, which you are seeing, are not laryngomalacia. You need to look at things. And when you are unable to find a diagnosis or the child is coming for repeated admissions, kindly please do refer to an expert, because we are complementary to each other. Now, this is one more interesting case. This is a case number 4, which has been referred from a tertiary hospital to me. Baby Y, who is a, 3 years old, who got admitted with fever, hepatic A, suspected to be dengue, referred to a tertiary hospital for a dengue-like picture, had features of septic shock, was treated accordingly. And during that time, the child had, as it's a septic shock, needed HFO, ventilated for a week. So post-extubation, the child developed a stridor. With this history, you definitely know there is some amount of subglottic edema which is causing the stridor, which was managed with dexamethasone, nebulizations with adrenaline, and got better and went home very happily. But to add to the story, this child, who was a 3-year-old, was a multi-triggered wheezer. Again, readmitted after 1 week for respiratory stress, which had upper respiratory tract symptoms and had a prolonged expiratory phase which is a wheeze, and a stridor was also obvious. So with this background of multi-triggered wheezing, they thought, yes, fine, because the child was okay, subglottic edema would have reduced. But again, because of this infection, the child developed one more episode. And they have treated like acute examination, but stridor was a bit persistent. And the parents got worried and again came for one more episode after 20 days with a stridor and a wheeze. Then they have did an HRCT basically for the upper airway also, including the chest cuts of upper airway. I didn't put the CT, and we did a bronchoscopy. So please note, so this is the vocal cords, which you are able to see. So the child is in a normal breathing, because when I do a bronchoscopy, I don't sedate the child. I want to see the vocal cords moving normal. No other issue. Now I've just passed through the vocal cords. Again, I came out. See, there is something which is narrowed down. So when I passed the bronchoscopy, I saw this narrowing immediately. So everybody have noticed this narrowing. So which definitely suggests there is some amount of, not some, there is a reduction of lumen to somewhere about 50 to 70%, which I will show you the classification, which fits into type 3 of subglottic stenosis. Now the same video when you pass down, so this is the properly you can see a subglottic stenosis. I had to change the scope from 4 to 2.8 to look much better, because it was very difficult. The most important thing is whether I was able to pass through this narrowed opening to down to look for the carina. Yes, I was able to. So this is a case of subglottic stenosis, which definitely requires, see, I would able to see the lower end of the, the trachea, which you have seen the carina and right and left main bronchus. So there is a subglottic stenosis and a bit of about 5 to 7 mm. Now, what is the management of a subglottic stenosis? Now, this is the purview of an ENT specialist or airway surgeon or an interventional pulmonologist who does a dilatation. It sometimes you may require a stenting. When you don't have any option and the child is having a near total obstruction, you may need to do a tracheostomy. So this child had a dilatation procedure. So this is the third most common congenital anomaly of the larynx, which is characterized by recurrent episodes of croup or a prolonged cough or with a barking cough. So this is grade 1, only 50% obstruction, grade 2, 50 to 70%, grade 3, 71% to 99%. So which you have seen is 71%, and grade 4 is no detectable lumen. So there was a seminar which was conducted recently by the International Pediatric Airway Associations, which were from all over the world. They talked about subglottic stenosis, about the various stunts and dilatation procedures. Whoever are comfortable with whatever procedure are, is they do it. But most of the pediatric airway surgeons do dilatation surgery rather than stunting, because sometimes stunt gets infected and you need to remove the stunt. So an acquired subglottic stenosis related to prolonged endotracheal intubation. The child was intubated only for a week, but still you could get a subglottic stenosis. So you could have a gastroesophageal reflex, an infection, and autoimmune disorders or iatrogenic disorders can also cause such cases. Now this would be my last case. I know I was a bit rushing, but this is one thing which everybody, this is also one of the cases which have been referred to me for only bronchoscopy. This is an 18-month-old master B who had recurrent sinopulmonary infection and diarrhea for last 6 months. And he has history of weight loss of 4 kg in the past 6 months. Now, this child, as you know, there is a recurrent sinopulmonary infection, diarrhea, weight loss. Is, you know, the differential diagnosis could be an immunodeficiency one, That is one possibility, or a PCD or a cystic fibrosis, whatever you think. But cystic fibrosis would present with also some of the type of infection. So they have done all the investigations because the child was referred to a tertiary hospital for a bronchopneumonia and a myocarditis. There was no history suggestive of immunodeficiency in the family members. But the interesting point is mother died 1 month back. She committed suicide. The cause was not known. A tertiary case hospital, he was treated for myocarditis and bronchopneumonia. Now, why did they refer to a pulmonologist at that stage? They were treating good. Everything went well. Only thing was, they were unable to wean off oxygen from the child. And they also did a HRCT. I will show you the next slide. The child was emaciated. There was a pallor. There was no clubbing or lymphadenopathy. There was mild subcostal intercostal retraction, and there was occasional bilateral crepitations. There was haptomegaly. Heart sounds were dual. Sensorium was normal. Hypotonia with diminished reflexes because the child was emaciated and everything. The investigation showed CBP of 8.8, total count of 9,000. 10% is lymphocytes. As everybody might have heard the lectures on immunodeficiency, an absolute count of less than 3,000 should be of suspicion, and 1.8 platelet count. So later during the course, the child had total count of only 4,500 and a platelet count of 54,000. So you are seeing a drop in platelet. There's something which is happening in the child. Immunoglobulin workup came out to be inconclusive. And we did a HIV for this child and it came out to be negative. And if you see a cardiomegaly heart, even though it's a rotated film, there is some amount of pericardial. But I will show you in the next picture. See, this is a ground glass appearance, which could be one of the features of your interstitial lung disease and commonly would be infective in such an origin. So they have tried everything. So they asked me whether the question was to do a biopsy or a BAL first and then go ahead. So because an IMAD is a procedure, we said, okay, we'll hold on to it because we had seen an algorithm when the child was otherwise stable, except for only requiring some amount of oxygen, the child was doing well. So I did a bronchoscopic alveolar lavage. I didn't have that video because somehow it got crashed and it came out to be Klebsiella pneumonia and pneumocystis jervaki, which is a positive, both were positive. When you see such a PCB, it could be an immunodeficiency, which already we all suspected, and immunoglobulin level were inconclusive. But still, what has happened is when we dig the history, why the mother died in such a short span when the child is 18 months of old, was the child, then later on they revealed that the mother was HIV positive. But the child who we tested HIV thrice was negative. Because the child has PCP and we were inconclusive, we sent a HIV.
We are not able to hear you. Yeah.
Sir, you're able to hear, sir, now?
Now, okay, please.
Okay. We have sent thrice HIV, HIV. It came out to be negative. Mother had a suicide, which was, when we digged it, the history came out to be HIV positive. So we did the HIV PCR RNA, which turned out to be positive. So all, in spite of all the investigations, we have done everything. But only thing was that whether to do a bronchoscopic alveolar lavage alone or a biopsy for identifying was a big question. These are all the cases which are real-time scenarios which were referred to me from various hospitals. Most of them were from Andhra Hospital, one from Guntur government. And I had many cases because of time constraint, I couldn't put those all the bronchoscopic videos. So approach to an ILD in a stable child, which we saw this one. CT scan, if the child is present, like your ground glass appearance, crazy pavement pattern, then it is, and you don't have any other diagnosis. If it is a newborn period, then you can have neuroendocrine hyperplasia of infancy, knee-high would have a typical CT scan findings. So when you have a non-diagnostics, your blood test would be somewhat helpful in your diagnosis, or a fiber optic bronchoscopy by doing a BAL and everything would have done. And if still you're not getting anything, then lung biopsy was indicated. Now you could have asked a question, why do you want to do a scopy twice in a child? Because the parents were not willing for a single go of investigation. We thought this indication, and we had at least one evidence that you can go ahead and try this one. So we did a bronchoscopic alveolar lavage. We had sent this respiratory panel, every respiratory panel to the child, and we got to be pneumocystis jervaki and Klebsiella pneumonia, which was only a mild one. So we thought this could be an HIV infection, and the child was referred and was treated for HIV and further management. I couldn't tell you some of the points, like a monophonic wheeze. I had a patient because, you know, Bal Chail, I'll tell you one history, because one of the child was referred from Eluru Hospital suspecting of tuberculosis. Gene expert was negative by a gastric lavage. They asked me to do a Bal because we wanted a microbiological diagnosis. So I did a Bal for the child. I didn't put that video. Sorry for that. And Bal CPNAT we have sent, and we also sent for a microbiologist, and we could see AFB staining in the with the microbiologist, and they have started treating with anti-tuberculosis drug, and the child got better. And some of the cases which I've referred were, a child had monophonic wheeze, receiving nebulizations, not responding well. So the commonest things which you have suspected when the child is not responding to the what you call monophonic wheeze to a bronchodilator is, one of the things are tracheobronchomalacia. I had some videos, but due to time constraints, I couldn't put those videos. When time permits, I'll put some of the other cases, and we will discuss the rest of the cases whenever time permits. And I owe this presentation, and I owe this whole thing to two people. One is the Children's Hospital at Westmed, where I've got trained. And this is Dr. Chetan Pandit, who took me to Australia, he had given me an opportunity. He's the son of the great pediatrician at Pune, Dr. Anand Pandit. He has taken me. I worked there for 1 year and learned a lot of bronchoscopy and pulmonology from that unit. I thank you one and all for your patient hearing. And if any doubts, I'll definitely answer your questions. Thank you once again.
So, thank you, Dr. Pawal Kalyan, for sensitizing us, all the general pediatricians, regarding various aspects that need the bronchoscopy. Now, Dr. Subramanian, will you please join for question and answer session? And Dr. Sandeep, please go through the question and answer session and please read out all the questions, please.
Sure, sir.
Dr. Subramanian is there?
Yes, I think sir is back. Hello. Sir Subramanian, sir.
Yes, unmute. Sir, unmute, sir. Unmute Subramanian, sir.
Unmute, sir. Sir, Subramanian, sir, please unmute, sir. Yes.
Correct. Attend to Dr. Pawan Kalyan, please go with them. Okay. Welcome back, sir.
Sir, Subramanian, sir.
I think that is busy phone.
If there are any questions regarding Pawan Kalyan, please read out.
I'm sorry, I was in the other webinar answering the questions on...
Sir, Andhra counts before Assam, sir.
So
please know that.
If there are questions, I will take it up.
Andhra comes before Assam, sir. Dr. Subramanian, sir.
No, I was in the other webinar, so I was taking question and answer. Now I'm fine. I'm out of that. Now tell me.
Fine.
Questions.
First of all, thank you very much, sir. Those were excellent talks and it was very informative as well. So we'll take few questions. So the first question for Dr.
Sandeep, before you go to questions, I saw Victor Jerome asking question there also and here also. Are the participants also in both the webinars? This is in a lighter vein. Victor, sir, I'm seeing your name. Okay.
So first question from Dr. Whittle, sir, a senior pediatrician. So while using a rescue like that of salbutamol, should we dilute it with normal saline to make it up to 4 ml or can we use the medicine as it is when we are using a nebulizer, sir?
Okay. I will answer scientifically first and then come to the practical part of it. If you fill the nebulizing chamber by 50%, 50% of the material gets aerosolized is the answer. So it depends on the size of the nebulizing chamber. Most of the nebulizing chamber's volume should be at least 50% filled. If not, it's not about the aerosol. It will not get effective aerosols and all size particles. See, nebulization is going to release the aerosols of different sizes. If I were to answer to the question, it is not normocytic, normochromic. The particles are anisopoikilocytosis from a nebulizer. Please understand the point. So if your chamber is less filled, then you will have more anisopoikilocytosis versus if it is well filled. So my answer is that please see that a volume is not less than 2 ml. 3 ml is preferred. 4 ml is much more preferred. But commercially available respules are having good volume. You need not take tension. And you don't have to dilute addition to commercially available respules. Pawan, do you agree with me? There is no need to extra dilute. Most of the times you are done. Second thing which I wanted to tell you is the purpose for which you are nebulizing. You are not deciding on the volume alone. Till the bronchodilatation happens, you are going to nebulize, isn't it? So if the first nebulization fails, you are going to give the second one, third one. So the question is how much drug you can save. The salbutamol is quite a cheap drug. You don't have to worry too much about it. Keep repeatedly nebulizing till you achieve bronchodilatation. So my answer is that if you use a jet nebulizer, the residual volume in the chamber is more. Ultrasonic nebulizer, volume is less. Mesh nebulizer, the residual volume in the chamber is less than 0.2 ml. So that means the inferior the type of the device, more is the residual volume and the wastage. The more the wastage, that means you should have more the volume initially in the chamber. So if you are using a jet nebulizer, make up the volume. Ultrasonic nebulizer, don't worry too much about the volume. And mesh nebulizer, don't worry about the volume at all.
Okay, sir. I think that answers the question. So next question for you, sir. So which nebulizer machine do you suggest is best in the hospital, sir?
Yeah, at least I would say don't, if you are using jet nebulizer, ask them to nebulize at home. If you're having ultrasonic nebulizer, maybe in the hospital. I mean, mesh nebulizer, don't use it because I said it's a good device. Don't use it because I will tell you the disadvantage of mesh nebulizer. It is not for your salbutamol. Please understand. It is for the antibiotics and surfactant and things like that. You don't need... see, I will tell you how to tell. You see, if you are using a very high megapixel camera, you will get loaded very fast. There is no need. See, it depends on the purpose. You don't need a 1 TB hard disk for your computer if you're not using. So my point which I wanted to tell you is that the mesh nebulizer has a different purpose. Suppose, let me ask a question to you. Suppose there is a croup and you want to nebulize. Which is the area? Proximal airways. Use a jet nebulizer, it's all right. It doesn't make difference. But if you want to deliver to alveoli and cystic fibrosis is the question, then you know you need finer devices. So it depends on where you want your device. If you're using for reliever, don't worry because you will repeatedly use. You don't use one nebulization. You may have to nebulize back to back. Suppose you are using it for long term, don't use a nebulizer, use an MDI.
Sir, what about oxygen driven nebulization? Keeping yes. Oxygen flow rate of, no. Say, 5 to 7 liters per minute and use it for nebulization.
If it is mild versus severe, I will not come to moderate. Moderate, I will leave it at the moment for discussion sake. Mild ones, just bronchodilatation may improve oxygenation. Even just a bronchodilatation may improve the oxygenation because have you not seen room air resuscitation in newborn? You don't need oxygen always. I'm just coming to that. Improving the entry into the lungs itself is an oxygenation. Whether you want to increase the percentage of oxygenation in a nebulization, in that case, the child has to be severe. And in that case, you just not only need bronchodilatation, you also need oxygenation in wherever you can get into the airways. Ultimately, it is the monitoring that is more important than how you are driving. And oxygen driven is safe. See, are we doing a good practice? My question is, many of you will just send them to nebulization room. Please, on case sheet or in the prescription slip, please record the pulse ox reading before you send them to the room. Auscultate before you send them to the room. When they come back, you examine the pulse ox and auscultate the child. This we don't do. Ho gaya kya? Over. Go. Come tomorrow. I'm sorry, Pawan. I think the most of them do this. Are we evaluating after giving nebulization? That's the crux of the matter. If you document a good bronchodilatation, that will also help you in future diagnosis, and it will also give a call to you whether you want to nebulize next. How frequently? Salbutamol is short acting. That means unless you treat the underlying cause, it is only 2 or 4 hours you can be happy.
Sir, in current situation, sir, so as we are thinking not to nebulize in the hospital setting because of the COVID crisis. So, and salbutamol mostly, as you're saying, suggesting should be with oxygen. So what about...
No. Wrong message. Sir. Severe, okay, I will tell you, you get a severe acute asthma in your clinic, Sandeep. You want to give MDI?
Sir, but in current setting...
Let it be COVID only. You want a child to die of it? No. Okay. Please, this is a myth. See, COVID is not a contraindication to treat.
Okay.
COVID positive children don't nebulize. If a child is documented COVID positive, don't assume everybody has COVID positive. At least for some more months or some more days. I don't know. See, the prevalence is not in my hands also. I can't be expert because I have not seen the COVID in the past. I know as much as anybody who is asking the question would know on COVID. But a message is very important. A COVID respiratory involvement will not respond to nebulization because COVID is not a disease of bronchospasm. That I can tell you very confidently. Somebody is COVID positive, don't be happy that I'm nebulizing the child and therefore the cough of COVID would come down with nebulization. No, it is you are dreaming. No. COVID would require oxygen then nebulization with salbutamol. That is point number one. But if a child is having a severe acute asthma or a medical emergency, you should nebulize but wear a PPE kit.
Okay.
Suppose a child requires endotracheal intubation, you will not do because it is going to give you COVID. So, and the procedure should not be withheld. Okay. You weigh the benefits versus the risk. That is your skill. See, does this child is going to be benefited by nebulization and I am okay, then fine. Suppose you think nebulization is just done like Dolly Bolly procedure and then you are risking for COVID, I would advise not to do, isn't it? So the misuse of and overuse of nebulization should be avoided. Judiciously, use of nebulization should be done with precautions. I will say nebulization is not an absolute contraindication. I will say nebulization is a relative contraindication for COVID. Is that fine? That message makes it very clear. It's a relative contraindication. I agree. But don't say, I am a man who will not nebulize. You go. Suppose if they take nebulization, a general practitioner, what will you do? If they buy a nebulizer and go and take it home, they may infect everyone. So it is better that you do the procedure with precautions and teach them what is to be done.
Sure.
Can I add, Sandeep? In the beginning, we will say no with fear for COVID. And 2 months from now, every pediatrician will nebulize in the clinic. I'm just thinking. You understand my point. So there is a fear and phobia. This phobia also will go off with time. There is a lot of fear now.
Sure. Thank you, sir. I think Dr. Pawan talk was very clear, so we don't have much questions. I just have a couple of questions for him. The first thing, I think you talked about supraglottoplasty. So I think it's advisable only when there is a failure to thrive. But I think we have been seeing quite a number of cases getting supraglottoplasty even for moderate laryngomalacia without any underlying cause like failure to thrive. So what's your say on that? Unmute,
Pawan. I would definitely say no for supraglottoplasty. The people are afraid of the noise, nothing more. Does the supraglottoplasty reduce the noise for a couple of time? Because I've shown you a case with SMA which presented thought of to be as an tracheoesophageal fistula. So in the scenario, given scenarios, in the ERS guidelines or on any guidelines, I have shown you the three steps of type 1, type 2, type 3. So if you are able to convince your patients, that's good. Possibility is that they are much more afraid of the noise. So they say that once you do a suprachoroplasty, your noise would reduce. But I've definitely said no for a suprachoroplasty. Just tell them, give time. The child would definitely heal better. And if the really child requires, if the child is having failure to thrive and everything, then definitely go.
But for laryngomalacia, can I come in with a couple of comments? Because it's such a common disease. Laryngomalacia, unlike the past, only wait and watch policy is not very well recommended, because laryngomalacia may coexist with other comorbidities which might be missed, and that picking up the child of those etiologies when there is failure to thrive is too late. It is like picking up a patient with tuberculosis when his muscles are gone. No, you should make an early diagnosis of frequent aspirations. You refer to Pawan Kalyan. Point number one. Point number two is supraglottoplasty, where we are going to cut that periepiglottic fold by ENT surgeons, that extra tissues, and make the larynx fit, is only an anatomical correction. It is not a functional correction. In fact, if this particular child with SMA or whatever neuromuscular diseases, I don't know, but if there is a neuromuscular disease and laryngomalacia, even after anatomical correction for the coordination to improve till the milestones of the child improve, it may take longer time. If you have benign laryngomalacia, but a severe stridor, in that case, the clipping of epiglottic folds as could be done by one of a person like Pawan, and if you can get it done, it's like stapling. So if they can do it, then it's fantastic. It may give relief of symptoms quite well.
Sir,
are you doing Pawan interventions?
No, sir. Let me add, sir, because there was a big seminar on an international pediatric airway association which was held at recently all over the world. There was a big discussion on laryngomalacia. They said that no suprachoroplasty, please.
Okay.
And if the child is thriving well, it is taken from ERS guidelines, thriving well, no issue. Then okay. Definitely, if you have an associated syndromic features like a Peary-Robin or any other thing, then you can think, but it should have, you're strongly suspecting that there's a moderate to severe laryngomalacia. First, prove it by laryngoscopy or a flexible bronchoscopy and say that you have to go for a suprachoroplasty.
Pawan, do you agree that there should be good evaluation rather than just saying wait and watch policy?
No, definitely, sir. If the strider, see, it is very difficult to convince a parent, because if the child says that only sound, the patient would be running from hospital to hospital and they won't get discharged. But you need to convince a patient that sound is not the thing. The larger the sound or the bigger the noise, it is not a severe laryngomalacia, or a smaller the noise, it's a milder laryngomalacia. So definitely, if you are suspecting something else, there is a normal cry, everything. But if you are seeing a muffled voice or anything with a stridor, definitely go ahead early. But a normal voice, normal cry, and the child, you suspect when the child is rotating, only getting agitated, then you can still wait, sir. But Pawan,
it may not be for everyone, but for myself, I'll ask a question to you.
Please.
The point which I wanted to tell is that many of the laryngomalacias may not be isolated. There could be laryngotracheobronchomalacia, in which case only bronchoscopy will give the diagnosis, but not clinical stridor alone. So if there is a coexisting bronchomalacia that is picked up only by you, not by me, by right. Hearing to the sound. So I would refer to you.
Definitely, sir.
Yeah,
I would agree with you. Next point, next question.
Okay, Dr. Pawan, I think another question. Just your experience with iotopexy, because I just heard about it. I've never seen and never used
it
for anything.
Again, there is a big discussion which went on in the Pediatric Airway Association people. When you have a severe trichomalacia, because definitely there is a role of iotopexy. For a mild to moderate, there are airway surgeons who do definitely stunting, where there is a role of stunting. But in a case of severe trichomalacias, yes, definitely there is a role of iotopexy. And iotopexy is being done for a couple of the candidates. But you should know whether it's a trichomalacia is a primary or a secondary. The secondary because of your vascular slings, double aortic arch. So you need to first evaluate what is the cause of trichomalacia and then need to plan for the further management.
Some of the malacias can be secondary to reflux, laryngopharyngeal reflux also.
because you just
sometimes
finish your
we'll never know whether that is primary or this is primary. So that is also a difficulty. Yeah.
Sure, sir. Sir, Durga Prasad, sir. Are you there, sir?